We've also seen that we have a lot of people who see us every Thursday. So welcome back and thank you for joining us again. I get often questioned, you know, why do many horses and riders suffer from so many ill-fitting saddles? And what is saddle fit? Is it based on opinion? Is it based on scientific facts? Is it based because somebody gets free saddles or sponsorship? Sometimes people say, oh, your thing, I think saddle fitting is just a fashion thing, you know, because in my old days, there was no saddle fitting. And is it saddle fitting because we need to do it because nature says so? No, so or is it because a certain person has association or they are government controlled because it's an authority or an imposed will? Often it's cognitive dissonance. What that means is that I, in my gut feeling, know something is wrong and it's not right, but I just tell myself, oh no, it's everything is good. So I kind of overtalk it, and though my gut feeling knows it's not, right? So, and then of course we have people who have a lot of saddle padding, you know. So I always say to people, you know, saddle fit doesn't exist. I wish we could all agree to call that, rather than saddle fitting, saddle checking. But saddle fitting is, I guess, everybody's word, you know. So as I said, in nature, the animals were never meant to carry humans. So if we check for saddle fit, and you don't have to be a master saddler or authority or have a course, you as a rider can always check if your saddle fit, you know. So I think we all need to go to the base, you know, why we have a saddle. The saddle is there to protect my back and the horse's back, you know. So we align the horizontal spine of the horse and the vertical spine of the rider, two different forces coming together, and neither the horse or the rider should have any discomfort, you know. And the horse always changes, the rider always improves. And unfortunately, if you have a very good trainer and the trainer trains your horse, the horse gets bigger, more muscular, or you're the trainer themselves, you know, the horse gets bigger, and or you're a pleasure rider, gets more conditioned, the three-dimensional shape where that saddle sits on will change on the horse. And sometimes the horse change, unfortunately, to the worst, the way people ride or what saddle pads they use. So we need to understand that neither the human or the horse is static, it's dynamic, there's a lot of movements, but there's also a lot of changes. So who there, when people say, well, who knows about the anatomy of the horse? I would always say, well, it's the veterinarians. They go for years to university to study the biomechanics, the anatomy of the horse, physiology of the horse, right? So, and some of them become professors, and some of them study the horse's back, like these three veterinarians. Wolfgang Meyerhofer, he's in Germany, who's also acupuncture and chiropractor. So they go in more and more detail. Veterinarians who write, you know, so Dr. Gerd Heuschmann is a big component who says, well, look at on top, you know, sometimes the rider causes all the problems. And then we have veterinarians who use very fancy tools. The professor I met in Sao Paulo in Brazil, she thought, you know, we want to take that approach that we need to fit the saddle to protect the horse and the rider. Right? And even in the racing world, we find more and more people say, hey, if my saddle fits better my horse might be faster and it's straighter. Isn't that something? If the horse doesn't deviate on the long line. In the Melbourne Cup, as well as the Kentucky Derby, both winners disqualified because they didn't go straight down the line. So saddle fitting, everybody in the racing world will be happy if we don't hurt the horse and the horse wins, you know, from jockey to trainer to owner. But what I love that there are more and more veterinarians, not manufacturers, not saddle maker like myself, the actual people who know anatomy inside out. They now look at the bones and they see the bone deformity when the horse is kept wrong, ridden wrong, or they have wrong equipment. And some of the veterinarians go as detail and write journals of the facial expression of the horse. You know, what does it mean? I always like, the horse doesn't know how to lie. You know, the eyes, the ears tell the truth. And I'm very, very proud to say that we have been nominated and we won the best educational book last year in Kentucky at the Equus Film Festival. So the saddle fitting, in my opinion, is scientific facts, right? And if you take nature in consideration, that the horses will change, and what changed tremendously, and this is why saddle fitting becomes such a nightmare. You know, what changes a lot? The breed, the gender, and the type of horse we use, and of course, the knowledge. You know, it's not just cowboys and Indians. We have now a sport, and we have now the horse more as a pleasure horse rather than a working horse. Very few people use horses as a working horse. Yes, there's some there, but the majority of the horses becomes a sport animal. And that changed dramatically in the breeding. You know, we see different types of horses now. We see horses who used to be rectangle, which means not as long legs, broad shoulders, longer backs. Now, the breeding got completely upside down. You know, we have upright angles, you know, so who am I to make comments like this? I mean, we have people from all over the world. One of the people who wrote a wonderful book, from Fluchttier zum Designerpferd. Unfortunately, that book is not in English. It's translated from the flight animal to a designer animal. And Barbara Schulte is very outspoken about it. You know, like, we know what we did with dogs and the breeding world. And some shepherds have really, really deformed hips now. And the same with horses. We have now bred horses who have a super, super problem. Why am I talking about this? Because I was taught my trade from the master saddler who was taught by his master saddler. So for years and years and years, there were people who taught people how to make saddles for the horse on the left. Now, the horses are bred like this. The majority of the sport horses, super long necks, super long neck, and very short saddle support area. That means the majority of the saddles are too long and sitting in the lumbar area, what causes a lot of pain. The most reality, however, and the biggest problem from all of them is that the doctor, Dr. James Worson, wrote a book, The Rider's Pain-Free Back. He mentioned very clear, there is a huge difference between a male and a female pelvis, lower back, thigh, the soft parts. And wouldn't you know, there is long-term damage for the lady as well as for the rider, male rider, if you don't ride in the gender-appropriate saddle. So for me, I just don't understand why so many people hurt in their saddle when we all know there is a massive difference between a male and a female saddle. So if I look at the one picture here, and that I modified from an article also written by a veterinarian, and Nancy Nicholson from Florida, she had an article and she showed the rider. You see the male shoulder, hips and heels, and look at the back of the butt. It's sitting on the horse's back. That's what we want to have. Nice contact in the seat, shoulder, hips and heels, the way nature had intended our spine. If I take the female who has a birth channel and more lordosis, means more curvature in the lower back, you notice that her butt cheeks are a little higher. That is due to the shorter tailbone and the more curvature a female has in the lower back versus the male. Now, this is not my idea. This is not what I come up with. This is facts, anatomy. This is nature. Riding on the horse, it's not. But sitting on the horse is something we adopted for thousands of years. But what changed? We have the majority of the riders who look this way now. Now, if I make a saddle, always like I did for 4,500 years, that lady will fall into a hole and the leg will go forward. And the shoulder, hips, and heels, what is so easy for a guy is possible, it's possible for the lady if you ride in the proper saddle. If you as a female sit in the non-gender appropriate saddle, that's exactly as ridiculous as if a male rider, they say a cowboy, goes in the jeans store, buys Wranglers, but goes to the female department. So he buys himself some female jeans, and now he goes and rides cutting, barrel racing, pleasure riding. There's no way there's a single male rider who would ride in female breeches, but many, many ladies learn to adopt to ride in a male saddle. Not because they like pain, because most people don't know what they don't know. Very talented rider, super talented rider, and has super horses, but unfortunately had wrong advice. And that lady sits in the saddle, that's the wrong video, sits in the saddle what is not very female friendly. So when it hurts in the front, rider leans back, and the horse will trot mainly out of the elbow, too much pressure in the back, not a very forward horse, because that rider has no pliable seat. You will always protect yourself. Here, no more pushing in the crotch, no more putting your knees out, your hips apart. The rider is pliable, and look how soft the horse, the same day. All we change is the female saddle, male saddle to a female saddle. Here, side by side, and you can clearly see she's not leaning back anymore, and the horse is just powering up.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Isn't that cool?
Amazing difference. Yeah.
And that's why I thought, you know, Mary Claire, everybody really loves their horses, don't you think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right? Nobody intends to hurt their horses.
Exactly. Yeah. And saddle fitting is always such a mystery, but yet there is a skeleton of a human and a skeleton of a horse, and that's what saddles mm-hmm. align, and that's it, without pain.
Right.
So and it, yeah, go ahead.
And it's such an important interface between two spines. Like, spines are, you know, such an important part of our bodies, and it's really important that we take care of that. And the interface in between those two spines is such an important role when it comes to riding that, yeah, this is incredible knowledge that you're sharing. And a lot of people don't think about in their day to day. But I think it impacts our lives so much, especially when you're riding in something that is damaging your body, damaging your horse without even knowing it, right? So yeah, incredible knowledge. Thanks, Jochen.
Oh, my pleasure.
Okay, so should we move on to some questions now? We have so many today.
Oh.
So many amazing questions, and I'm really excited. Okay, great. So the first one is we got it on Facebook, and the person is asking, this is about SVRL. So there are so many different saddle fitting schools out there that exist. Why is it that Schleza went with SVRL, and what makes SVRL stand out? Saddle Fit for Life.
Okay, so let me start when I was, after I was riding many years, and I noticed, okay, I can make saddles now. I learned how to make saddles, and I ask all different opinions. Every saddle maker has their own ideas. But mm-hmm. when it comes to saddles fitting to the horse, I couldn't find anything until I came to England to the Society Master Saddler, SMS, Society of Master Saddlers. And there is, that's a very old school. And then there's a school in England called the MSFI, Master Saddle Fitting Association. And the list goes on and on and on. And we have more horses who get really hollow behind the withers. Okay. And the saddler looks at this and says, oh, wow, the saddle is too tight. But the saddler also says, if I make the tree tight and I stuff my wool panel in there, then the muscle can't grow. So if I make it wide so the muscle can grow, it will crush the withers. So I hear all these different opinions from different schools. And when you start reading up what veterinarians suggest, they say, you know, a scapula moves upwards, backwards. And not only does you have room for the muscle to grow, you also have to have room for the shoulder to come through. Otherwise, all this will be squished. Mm-hmm. So I saw this cool diagram from a veterinarian who wrote about saddle fitting. Now, she doesn't have a saddle fitting school. She doesn't make saddles. But she says, you know, I'm a veterinarian who does chiropractic, acupuncture, and I want to share with everybody out there what the cross-section in the wither area looks. You've got your vertebrae, your ribs, and the spinal processes. Pretty high, obviously, in the wither area. The splenalis is a very narrow muscle, what starts at the base of the withers and goes underneath the shoulder to the middle of the neck. The trapezius, same thing. Look how narrow that trapezius is. Mm-hmm. Same as humans, what goes from the middle of the neck to your shoulders. And that helps the shoulder to move upwards, backwards, and then from the shoulders to the base of the withers. Very thin. And then latissimus, you see here the latissimus, the blue one, same like on a human, what goes from the shoulder back to your rib cage. So that's a very thin muscle. And then you see a very thick, a very, very thick muscle here. That's the longissimus muscle, okay? So since thousands and thousands of years when saddles were fitted to horses what had to perform in war or plowing a field or carrying people from A to B or soldiers, they're always, if you look at all the saddles or working saddles, Western saddles, they always base their contact on this big fat muscle. But most saddle fitting schools say you have to have it on this narrow or on the trapezius muscle, which is right here where the dry spots is. And then the atrophy happens. Mm-hmm. So after being to so many different schools and listen to them and hearing some students literally say, that saddle did not fit this horse at all, but the person who lets the student pass owns this company, and if I let that saddle fail because it doesn't fit, I fail. So I had to pass the saddle even if it didn't fit the saddle. So I always say, ask the purpose. What's the purpose of the school? What do they really want to do? Do they want to push a certain brand or do they want to push a certain idea? So this is why Schlezer went to the veterinarians and to the gynecologist and to the medical doctors and says, we want to learn how muscles and bodies of riders and horses work. We want to learn what happens if you squish the wither muscle or what happens if you put the saddle where people for thousands of years put the saddle on the longissimus muscles, okay? And the reason why we follow Saddle Fit for Life, it's not based on any brand, right? So you can have any saddle fit to the anatomy of the horse. Now the question is the manufacturer following it? Such as, should you have a saddle sit on the spine? Okay, so there's some manufacturers say, no, saddle should sit hollow. Okay, in other words, like this bridge, right? Should sit in the front and the back. So some saddle fitting school teach that. So if I would turn around again to say to the veterinarian, I want to make really nice saddles and I want to have them fit. And I would ask the veterinarian, they would say, are you insane? If you dig the saddle in the back and in the front like this, the horse will stumble, will atrophy in the shoulder and in the loin. That makes no sense. So, okay, fine. Then I go away from that school. The other school says, if you make the channel nice and narrow, because a wide channel on the horse's spine is just fashion, you should have a narrow channel. Yeah, well then what you do, you're gonna pinch all the nerves and the wither muscle and the spinal muscle, the multifidus. So that doesn't make any sense. So we followed Saddle Fit for Life because it's very simple. You know, we've been shown and explained what every little spinal nerve can do to the horse. Organ-wise, anything from colic to ulcers. Then here, the back. Have you ever ridden a mare in season and you push too much in the back there, close to the ovaries? Good luck. Yeah, I'm sick and tired riding a horse, and the second I get off the horse, he pees while I'm riding, or he bucks. Why would I put any pressure on the bucking point? Why would I put any pressure on the lung meridian points? So if I have on the internet for free books, more than you can count, where all this is explained by veterinarians, not saddle fitters, not people who have an agenda. These veterinarians have one goal: to help the horse, because their code of honor is do no harm. So why wouldn't I fit the saddle away from these sensitive spots and fit it, like veterinarians say, gender appropriate? I'm sorry, not veterinarian, medical doctors say, if you want to fit a saddle without hurting the horse, you got to fit it first to the rider on top. Don't have the rider bounce around and hurt the horse. So who am I, master saddler for over 42 years in business, who learned from a master saddler who worked in the company, what is over 130 years in business? Why would we ask a medical doctor, or why would even question that there's a difference? So I chose Saddle Fit for Life because I want to know the why, and I want to do it without causing long-term pain to horse and rider and damage. And a little bit more precise work, but in the end of the day, no rider wants to hurt the horse. They all want the horse moving comfortable, horse and rider, and we love them. Right? So I don't think anybody's there, oh, can you please fit my saddle with your opinion? No, they want to do it properly.
Exactly. Great answer, Jochen. Thank you. So the next question we have comes from Instagram. And this woman also included a nice little message at the beginning of her question. She said, hi, Jochen. First of all, thank you all for all that you do. Here's the first question. What is your advice if the saddle lays exactly on the last rib, or exactly on the line of the last rib, or 2 centimeters further? Is that substantial discomfort for the animal? Thank you.
Okay, so the question is very easy to answer, is yes and no. Because it doesn't hurt the horse if it doesn't move. If it's on the line already, you most likely will come close to that very tip of the first lumbus versus processes. And most riders, they ride around a corner. They do lateral work. The second the horse bends, the saddle in the back shifts to the left or to the right just a little bit. But when you do a shoulder in or renvers or travers, okay, what you do, you stretch the opposite side, and the, let's say you bend the horse to the left, okay? Then this side becomes shorter. So when you go around corner, the saddle now is on behind the line. And if you're 2 centimeter on the line, this is the most vulnerable spot. It is so flimsy, right? I always recommend, if you have a horse what is younger than 8 years, you want to have a saddle 1 centimeter or almost half an inch in front of that last line. Because over age, that area shortens. The horse goes way back, it shortens. The horse gets more shoulder muscles, the scapula comes further back, it shortens. As I said in my introduction, we have this massive problem that we have horses now with short backs and still saddles what don't take that in consideration. So, I used to say a little bit is not bad, but that is just as bad if a girlfriend says to their boyfriend, I'm just a little bit pregnant. Little bit pregnant doesn't exist. Either I am pregnant or I'm not. And the same thing with the horses. Either you hit this spot or you don't. So my answer was yes or no. If it's just on the line and the horse doesn't move, you're okay. But if the horse moves and eventually has to bend around a tree, or you go up and down the hill, or you do any lateral work or jumping, the horse will get. A good example is if you have pressure on the elbow, but somebody touches your funny bone, all of a sudden you get that electric shock. That's what the horse will feel.
Awesome. Thanks, Jochen. That was a great answer. And very quick. and to the point, which is awesome. Which is a rarity, but that's awesome. It's great. We appreciate your long answers too, because we know how much goes into all of this, and it's, you know, we appreciate it. We're learning. It is dense material a lot of the time. I get a lot of comments saying, wow, there's so much that I don't know. There's so much to learn. But that's why we really appreciate you taking the time to do these live streams and to sit with us and like help us grasp all of this, because it really is important to understand and to know. Okay. All right, so let's move on quickly to the next question, the third question of the day. So this person says, my coach is sponsored by a specific saddle company, which is measured and fit to her and her, to me and my horse. How does this benefit me and my horse?
Oh boy. Okay. I got to be very careful that I don't offend our sponsor trainers and our trainers who are sponsored. So first of all, anybody who does that for a living knows how tough the horse industry is. There's so much to consider, so many costs, so many items, and saddle is just another cost. If there's a company who sponsors the coach with equipment, they greatly appreciate it, and of course help their students gear them towards the company. So that's very often the idea of coaching. However, sometimes the coach gets quite a bit of money, and again, there's nothing wrong with this, kind of like Tiger Woods when he was top of the game. He got millions of dollars endorsing the company he endorsed. I think it was Nike back then. And the same with top trainers. So when trainers get money for riding in the product, again, it's nothing wrong with that. That helps them, the expense they go through. But very often, they are in the middle and teach the riders, and they now have to sell, because part of their contract, a saddle to the students. Different companies do different contracts, but the goal here is the students ride their saddles. We want the same thing. My biggest fear is that they end up with cookie cutter saddles. If I sponsor a saddle to a top rider and I fit that horse and that rider, that will not fit their students or their horse. It's very different. If you multiply, there's 11 different items what has to fit to the horse and 15 to the rider. And if you're good at math and you multiply all them into one, imagine how many variables there are. It's mind-boggling. Mm-hmm. So the direct answer is beware when the coach sells saddles or is endorsed. I appreciate it that if I would be a coach, if I get a little bit financial help, and for that, I will guide my student towards the company. If the company does not come out, measures you and measures the horse, if the company has not a saddle, but can be adjusted in the width and in the angle of the tree, as well in the length of the saddle, I'm not interested. The company does not offer me a specific male or female saddle. If my coach is a girl, why would I want to ride in my coach saddle? I wouldn't ride in her female jeans or female breeches. So if that company doesn't do that, then I will say beware when you buy saddles. You get stuck. Unless you like to buy saddles to help personally the coach as well financially. But that's the job of the company who endorses the coach. Did that answer the question, Mary, Claire?
I think so. I think it did. It's kind of a difficult question to answer, but I think you did a great job. The next question I'm really excited about, because I'm actually really interested to know what you think. This is something that actually has been on the back of my mind for a while. So it's funny that it has come up in the questions. There are so many saddleries out there, and not very many of them seem to be offering gender appropriate saddles. And to me, it seems very obvious that every saddlery should be addressing this. But why not? Why don't you think more saddleries are catering to gender appropriate saddles?
Okay, so this is based on my opinion. And I can only say as a manufacturer, My raw materials is mainly leather. And then I have also to consider all the different types of leather. Then I have different types of linen, glue, staples, thread, metal, and the main part, the second biggest after my leather, is my saddle tree. When I make a model, I want to have that particular model in all six sizes, maybe even as a pony size. So by the time I have, let's say, five models, let's say I have 10 models, that means I have 60 saddle trees in my company, what I store. Mm-hmm. So if I have 60 saddle trees, I'm gonna turn off my screen to show you what I mean with saddle trees. The most common trees is the wood tree. Many, many English saddle companies use that. And you can see how the bars are slanted here. So the leg falls nicely. And then it gets flatter to the back. So if I have a certain width through here, for a male, we don't want that too narrow because we have more space between our upper inner thigh. A woman wants that completely the opposite. She wants that narrow through there because between her upper inner thigh, there's not a lot of space. And if I go in the back of the tree, that's where my seat bones seat are. On the male, we want it narrow. On a female, we want that part wide. Now, that says, so what? Then you have 60 trees. So you have 120 trees. That can't be so much money because you got to have male and female saddles. But unfortunately, the width here comes not in narrow and wide. It also comes narrow, medium, wide. And same here, narrow, medium, wide. Now, if I multiply 3 times 3, that's 9. 9 times 60, oh my God, now I'm at 540 trees. So you can see that when I manufacture gender appropriate saddles, my inventory went way up. But mm-hmm. I don't think that's the biggest problem. I think the biggest problem is what many companies could say, I have that kind of a cash and I will have all these different trees. Now, obviously the way the flaps, the seat and the panels are fitted to these different trees, you need all new pattern. So you have to invest quite a bit of inventory. Again, the market is there, would afford it. But my number one reason is they don't do that is because if the lady rider would sit comfortable in the saddle, okay, and feels home in the saddle, absolutely perfectly straight in the saddle, like this lady here in the black saddle, shoulder, hips, and heels, nothing hurts, no pain. She can swing her hips, her knees can soft, her ankles are down, she can lean back, lean forward, doesn't get killed in the crotch, doesn't bleed, doesn't hip pain, knee pain, absolutely comfortable. She wouldn't buy another saddle. Mm-hmm. If I have 9 different features, what is difference between male and female saddle? I just showed you 2 on the tree, but there's actually 9, okay? And if I have 9 different features on the saddle and one of them doesn't fit, the rider will always squirm, always shift a little bit, okay? So what will that do? That will change that the customer will buy very fast another saddle, another saddle. And what we have seen in the last 42 years, that I can only speak for myself, when I started riding, and that was over 50 years ago, but I remember we didn't change so much saddles, constantly buying another saddle. So the industry had way, way less manufacturers, good leather, but now in the last 2 years, another 60 saddleries just popped up who make saddles, nothing wrong with this, but the market is there and they're all looking for saddles. Why? Because they're constantly changing. You could say, yeah, because I want a bling saddle, I want a blue saddle, I want a rhinestone. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about not being comfortable. I give you the best example. You all had shoes, all of you, what you really, really like. They become like second skin. And your partner, husband or wife or friend says, oh my God, throw those ugly shoes away. They're horrible. And you won't, because they're like your second skin. Imagine you would have a saddle what feels like those shoes and still look good and fit your horse. You wouldn't throw them away. So I think the reason why there's such a rarity and why other manufacturers do not offer female saddles, because they want to keep selling your saddles. That's the end of it. We have a 0.09% market share. I will never supply North America with all the saddles. But if I can supply customers with the right saddle at the beginning, and every customer or country or company thinks the same way, you could have customer for life, and these people will recommend you for the next customer. So my goal is, besides advance in the knowledge we get from veterinarians and doctors and gynecologists, my goal is to get the right saddle for the female right away, or the male right away. What other people's do is just a guess. And that was my guess. Saving money, saving inventory, and getting the customer buying the saddle what is sponsored by so-and-so rider or whatever's in fashion.
Awesome answer. Thanks. Thanks, Jochen. That's such a great answer. And it's an educated, guess you could say about what's going on in their minds. But I think that's really how Schleza is seen as a dignified company in like a sea of people, a sea of fast fashion, really. So I think that's really admirable that, not only are we kind of representing that, but we're also trying to implement more education and more knowledge and spreading that knowledge, because it's, knowledge is power. And the more that we can communicate what really has to be going on behind the scenes to provide that saddle fit, the better it is, right? And the more that we can help horses and riders around the world just avoid long-term damage. And that's the goal, right? So awesome answer. Thanks, Jochen.
And I have to be careful how I answer this. And, mm-hmm. You always offend people, in my case, unintentionally. But I can only recommend for you as a community, for the riders, ask them, can I try the model XYZ in mm-hmm. a male and in a female model? And if they say I don't, then go to the next one.
Yeah.
Because you never.
Once you know better, you got to do better.
Mm-hmm. Once you set in the difference between male and female saddle, you will never believe that you actually spend all your money and all your riding lesson and all your time on riding and with wrong equipment. That mm-hmm. is kind of like you're putting your blouse backwards or your bra backwards. That is how ridiculous that is. Mm-hmm. So it's these measurements you see here on the screen, the bottom one on the bottom right, these two, just alone, the difference in the upper leg versus lower leg is completely the opposite, male and female, completely opposite. So I didn't make up the rule, mm-hmm. right? So these are simple things which is being told to us by medical doctors, not saddle mm-hmm. makers or marketing people. They say, hey, if you really want to make it nice for the horse so the rider has a pliable seat, okay, because that's why you see so many people sitting, this is from clinician, too many riders have cramped seat, no supplements, chair seat. Or they yell at them, you need an independent seat, or they bounce on the horse around, or they have super tight hands. These are comments, not because these riders say, I have to learn how to ride. No, there's a massive difference. The hip pain is induced because people don't know, that little nerve here, sciatic nerve, so quick injured because they look at the distance between mm-hmm. female and male thighs. Completely different. Mm-hmm. Right? And if you don't know that as a rider, you're just shaking your head. It says, why did my company, who I buy saddles from, didn't tell me? Well, I give you my best guesses and opinion.
Yeah, and now we're at a point where, you know, the information is spreading, and now when you know better, you have to do better, right? And so intuitively, we know that the male and female anatomy are completely different. Like, we must know this at a core level within ourselves, right? And so when people know better, it's about doing better for you and your horse, right? So
I always compare it to the cell phone. No? You tell people, someday you can pick up a little device and you can talk to somebody as if they're next door around the world. People will think you're there's no way it works.
Yeah.
Or and for us master saddlers or saddle makers or companies who've been there fourth, fifth generation, you know, we never have seen so many female riders. So there were never that kind of a demand. But in the apparel, you know, as a male rider going to the tack shop, trying to find good apparel for riders, for male riders, you don't see it. It's all female, right? But in the saddle world, it's still like we're still in the 1800s.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. Hopefully with these webinars and as we keep trying to spread the message, more people will wake up. I think we're you know, experiencing that awakening, you know, as it's kind of playing out, but it's still a process, I guess, you know. Let's take our last question for the day, because there's already only 15 minutes left, which I think is insane. This hour, it always flies by, you guys. Thank you for joining us and for leaving your comments. Tell us where you guys are from. I'm just reading through some of your comments now, but if we don't answer your question in this live, we will answer it in the next, and we'll save all your questions. But right before we get into the next question, or the final question, I'm just going to mention the bridal giveaway. So I'm going to post that in the YouTube chat. So anybody who's on Facebook and wants to know about the bridal giveaway, just log on onto our live stream on YouTube and click that link, and you will be taken to the Viper website so that you can enter into that giveaway. And it's a double bridal, and the giveaway ends tomorrow, so you'll have 24 hours to enter. And best of luck to everybody who would like to enter. And let's move on to the last question of the day, which is from Instagram as well. Oh, this is a doozy. This is a big question, Jochen. Oh. I don't know if we're gonna make it in between 15 minutes, but we're gonna do our best. So is there really that much difference between a male and female rider? We kind of sort of answered this a little bit already, but maybe we can go back into it a bit more.
For me, it's probably the biggest a difference is how your spine will feather the horse's back. We all have ridden bareback and we know how the back moves up and down. You cannot train pain. You can ride until you're numb in certain areas, but your body will react before you actually know what's happening. So you're going to pivot your back and you put enormous pressure on L4 and L5. Many, many, many riders have that long-term pain because it's sheer protection, okay? Just like horses can get kissing spine, human can kissing spine, you know, called the Bastrop syndrome. You know, so there's so many top riders who have been operated on L4 and L5. And many people say, oh, so-and-so has ridden all his life in a saddle and she's an Olympic rider. Yeah, and been 3 times operated on lower back, Europeans as well as Americans. On the end of the fingertips, you have a lot of sensitivity, a lot of sensitivity. All your nerves and blood vessels are there. And those tiny little nerves, right, the tiny little veins here, they're called capillaries. And we don't need a lot of pressure before that area goes numb. And when I'm thinking of certain areas in the saddle, what could rub the rider? Is it the crotch? Is it the hips? what you will do, you will compensate. And when you compensate, I saw I talked earlier about the nerves here, okay? You will compensate in your lower back. So when you see good riders, they have a six pack or eight pack, really flat stomachs and really strong. Many people get super tight back muscle and they say, you know, when I ride, I don't have back muscles. But when I don't ride, oh my God, my back is killing me. These are the first sign that your disc is under attack, okay? So because when you ride, you tighten your lower back muscle, which is the wrong way. And I have a beautiful video from the Spanish riding school who did an animation like that. Super, super. We have that in our class. But what will happen then when you stop riding and you relax, now all of a sudden your disc starts screaming and then your muscle spasms up again. So is there a massive difference? Yeah, because you are now going to sit with your chest over the balance alignment point of the horse and you're not squishing yourself back in the back of the saddle, because the front of the saddle, right, will hurt you. And I cannot emphasize this enough, that when I'm looking at the male and the female pelvis, skeleton on the side, the girl needs to ride just like the boy, shoulder, hips, and heels. The girl needs to be just like the boy, use the four curves, a shock absorption. The girl needs to do the same with the with the hips and the knee and the ankle, needs to feather. But if you're sitting on the most important eight, your seat, and it's completely different, lacking in the back, I'm gonna turn off my computer to show you a tree. In my front, here you can see there's various different trees. This tree here has a pre-foam, and then there's just a little piece of foam on top, and you can see the ridge here. So there's a clear ridge in the front, okay? And every saddle maker has learned from his saddle maker, in the ground seat, in the seat, you make a ridge. I call this a ridge. So maybe you can see it better. If I put a ruler on top, you can see how high that is in the crotch area. Now, if a male sits on that, right, absolutely no problem, okay? That ridge will actually help me to put my parts left or right. So look on the top here, the vertebrae, I can pivot back and forth until the cows come home. I will never hit my pubic symphysis or the side of my pubic branches where the underwear goes through. If you're a female and you have a birth channel, which is wider seat bone, but the main part is your pubic branches are flat and down. This little bump is where your underwear goes. And this front here, the pubic symphysis, is lower. Again, this is neutral. I could put the rider this way. That means you would lean with your head on the croup, but that's not how your pelvis is natural. This is level. So if a lady sits in a male seat, what you hit first is the crotch, the bone, the pubic symphysis. Then you hit your soft parts. And by the time you sit on your seat bones, look at this. Look how far you sit back. Wow. So what are you gonna do? A, you fall back because your tailbone is shorter and your cheeks, your butt cheeks, your gluteus maximus sits higher, okay? You're gonna go this way, then you're gonna lean back. Now you're sitting on the back of the saddle and you're driving the saddle like a water ski into the shoulder. Will you feel massive difference? Absolutely. Because the female saddle has a hole in it. That is flat. Does a guy like this? Absolutely not. Why? Because I don't know where my parts go. But a saddle maker could easily make a foam here so he's happy again. For a lady, there's no foam, there's a hole. So now she can sit without being crushed in the front on the bone level, okay? And she can give the pliable seat if the support is there. I don't care if it's a jumping saddle, general purpose saddle, whatever, okay? Then and only then you can ride soft through the horse. Now, what is the big, big difference? What makes it so massively different? Well, the answer, I always say, is in the picture, says more than 1,000 words. You say that all the time, right, Mary Claire?
Oh, yeah, for sure. Okay.
And again, no support in the back, mm-hmm. cutting her in the crotch. She leans back. She got to take that concussion in the lower back. And she's like twice her weight. Even she likes to ride soft. Horse is almost restricted to use his hind leg. Now, hole in the crotch, support under the back. She's supple, she's soft, and now she lifts the horse up in the front. Look at how the horse comes out of the shoulder.
It's like but night and day.
The best part, I like Mary Claire, look at the hind leg on the right horse. Look at mm-hmm. how much active the hind leg yeah. is. Because on the left, the rider sits with the full force into the loin of the horse. That poor animal can't go. Mm-hmm. So I think it's time, you know, like Darwin says, you know, you got to adapt to the changes. If you're a saddle maker, wake up and smell the coffee. The majority of the riders are not your guys anymore. They are mm-hmm. ladies, okay? Are there male riders? Of course. But just like the horses have changed in their physique, what also has changed is that we have the majority of the riders are female, right? There's not just guys anymore. So if you don't believe a word I say, fine. If you don't believe what the medical industry say, fine. If you want to love your horse, follow your gut. Follow your gut and be soft to your horse and kind to your horse. Everything else, it's easy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And I think along the way, it seems like the industry has somehow lost its way in terms of what a saddle should really be. And people have gone down the route of just fast fashion and trying to make it look a certain way or look great. But like the whole purpose of the saddle is to be the interface in between those two bodies, those two spines. Exactly. That photo is amazing. So we really need, it's amazing that we have you here, Yafin, to help explain all these things to us, because we really need to reinvigorate this into the industry and help remind people what the saddle really is about and what it really needs to accomplish.
You know what, I really find sad that we didn't get to it, because most people try so hard and they have very expensive saddles, okay? But they take very expensive lesson from top trainer, okay? But it puts them in the chair seat like this, and then they drive the saddle into the shoulders. There's five reasons why the saddle goes forward. Maybe we can cover that next time. Mm-hmm. And there is another big problem if we don't have a proper fitted saddle for rider or horse. It's bouncing in the cantle. You know, bouncing the cantle or the cantle going left to right is a massive problem.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we can cover that next time. But I can't
Sounds
believe
good.
It's already over again.
I know, we already it just flies by every time. And I haven't even peeked over to our comments lately, but thank you guys so much for joining us and for commenting and asking your questions. I'm going to take note of all the questions that I see here on Facebook and as well as YouTube. Thank you guys for joining us, Sarah, Bethany, everybody. Appreciate it. Next time we will get to your questions, I promise. We do have a lot kind of even leftovers from today, which is crazy. They're adding up pretty quickly, but thank you for your time, Yafin. I think I speak on behalf of everybody tuning in when I say we really appreciate getting to pick your brain and getting to talk or just even hear you discuss all of these things and help us understand it all. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
My pleasure. I like to say goodbye to everybody with this saying, remember, the person who knows the how will always follow the person who knows the why. Ask the people why they do what they do, and you will have it much easier with the saddle fitting quest. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Yafin.